Tonight on Reporting Scotland, the Scottish Government says Theresa May's Florence speech leaves too many questions unanswered. We'll hear from Scottish businesses who trade with the EU as the Prime Minister proposes a transitional period after Brexit. The controversial proposals for new flight paths over Edinburgh. The CAA blocks the move on technical grounds. A year after the disappearance of Fife airman Corey McCaig, his mother says she knows he might never be found.
We will find a way of dealing with that, but the only way I know I'll personally be able to deal with that is if I know I've done everything possible first.
Also on the programme, we look ahead to the first Old Firm game of the season, with Rangers hoping to dent Celtic's recent dominance. And it's a race to the top. The speed climbers competing in this weekend's World Championships in Edinburgh. Good evening. The Scottish Government say there are still many unanswered questions after the Prime Minister set out her vision for Britain's Brexit negotiations in a keynote speech in Italy. Theresa May has proposed a transition period of up to 2 years after Britain leaves the EU in 2019. But ministers here want a long-term commitment to the single market to protect Scotland's economy. Here's our political correspondent, Andrew Kerr.
In the birthplace of the Renaissance, the Prime Minister attempted to breathe new life into Britain's Brexit negotiations. Theresa May came to Florence to call for a new relationship with the EU, a British bespoke deal.
The question now is whether we, the leaders of Britain and of the EU's member states and institutions, can demonstrate that creativity, that innovation, that ambition that we need to shape a new partnership to the benefit of all our people. I believe we must, and I believe we can.
Mrs. May suggested a 2-year transition period to smoothly implement the Brexit deal. Free movement will continue for EU citizens, but they will need to register. And the UK will honour its budget commitments over the period, thought to be £18 billion.
So in sunny Florence, the Prime Minister was optimistic about Britain's future relationship with the EU. But back home in Scotland, there's a far gloomier reception to her speech.
Frankly, we're still not that much further forward about what she wants, what Brexit actually means. And that's something that has to concern us all. This is so important. It's important for young people, the economy, our environment. It affects each and every one of us.
Indeed, the Scottish Government's looking for a long-term commitment to the single market. But the idea of a bespoke deal for Britain was welcomed.
We're the only country in the world that, at the point at which we leave, are already going to comply with every rule and regulation that the EU has. So we're not a Canada, you know, we're not a Norway, and we're looking for something different. We're looking for a UK model, and that's what we're going to be negotiating with. And I think this is a really mature start to that.
The EU's chief negotiator welcomed the constructive spirit of the speech, but this is just the start. Andrew Kerr, Reporting Scotland.
Employers groups here have welcomed the Prime Minister's call for a 2-year transition period after Brexit, but there's a warning that a failure to reach a trade deal with Europe could cause a serious shock to the Scottish economy. Here's our business correspondent, David Henderson.
Welcome to one of our cheese fridges. We have a number of Scottish hard cheeses here for supply to the Scottish food service market and speciality retail, and also some for export. We export.
Selling the Scottish cheese to the French might seem like an impossible task, but that's just what this food supplier from Pennycook has done, with an order for 300 kilos. What then if trading rules change after Britain leaves the European Union? Will it still be possible to sell in this way?
For that size of order, where the margins are relatively thin, we're not supplying containers. We just wouldn't do it. If there was any more red tape to go through, it just wouldn't work. I don't think we'd be able to do it because we would need to spend more time on it, employ people to focus on getting all the paperwork. So those size of orders for us wouldn't happen.
In recent years, we've got used to buying food and drink from all over Europe, whether that's French chocolate, or Greek olive oil, or balsamic vinegar from Italy. But of course, it's a two-way street, and Scotland's exports to Europe last year alone were worth more than £12 billion.
But those talks on Brexit have been an uphill struggle. So this leading economist told me there's a lot at stake.
It's nearly 45% of all exports that from Scotland go into the European Union. But it's even wider than that. It's links into supply chains, it's access to workers. And if we get to a situation where we wake up at the end of this process with no deal, then companies are going to find themselves in completely, you know, different trading relationships outside of the markets they've been operating in, and that will have a serious economic shock.
An off-the-shelf Brexit deal with Europe doesn't look likely, so that trading relationship, and so much that relies on it, remains unclear. David Henderson reporting, Scotland, Penicuik.
We're joined now by our political correspondent Nick Eardley, who's at Westminster for us. Nick, what happens now?
Well, Sally, Theresa May hopes that some of the impasse we've seen in recent weeks in Brexit talks will be overcome. For the European side, they have said that they welcome her tone, but they want to see specifics about what her proposals might mean. And remember, none of this is guaranteed. It all goes back to the negotiating table on Monday when those talks resume in Brussels. And domestically too, there will be much debate about what happens after any proposed transition. The Scottish Government have welcomed the idea, but they want the Prime Minister to move towards their idea of long-term membership of the single market. There's still much to be discussed on this.
Thanks very much, Nick Eardley. Edinburgh Airport are expecting to resubmit within weeks their controversial proposals to alter flight paths. It's almost a year since the Fife airman Corrie McCaig disappeared after a night out in the Suffolk town of Bury St Edmunds. Labour leader Jeremy Corbyn has demanded that Holyrood gets more and wider powers as a result of Brexit. Speaking before his party's annual conference this weekend, he also said Labour had made progress in Scotland, but there was more work to be done. He's been talking to our political correspondent, David Porter.
For Jeremy Corbyn.
Jeremy Corbyn likes Scotland, and according to his supporters, Scotland likes Jeremy Corbyn. His backers say he and his policies of greater public spending were one of the reasons Labour did better than expected here in June. Against most predictions then, the party now has seven Scottish MPs. It's no secret that Mr Corbyn and Kezia Dugdale, who resigned as Labour's Scottish leader last month, did not always see eye to eye. Two MSPs from very different wings of the party, Anis Sawar and Richard Leonard, are now vying to replace her. Mr Corbyn thinks the contest is an opportunity. He won't endorse a candidate, but he's clear of the qualities the new leader needs.
What we need is a leader who's prepared to get out there in all the communities all the time and listen to people, as well as speak at public meetings and events and rallies, and develop a radical economic agenda for Scotland that does deal with issues of inequality, poverty and injustice, but above all, offer decent hope to young people.
Mr Corbyn thinks the contest is an opportunity. He knows to stand any chance of getting into Downing Street, Labour has to do far better in Scotland. On the fault line of Scottish politics, independence, the Labour leader is clear. There's been one referendum that was conclusive. There is no need for another. He's equally resolute on the other overriding political issue of the moment, Brexit. Like the Scottish government, he believes UK ministers are guilty of a power grab.
Powers that have been taken to Brussels, which affect regional development anywhere across Europe, which are Brussels' powers at the moment, will obviously be returned to the UK on Brexit. Those powers should go to Scotland, to Wales and to English regions. We will make sure that happens. I want to see a process of strong devolution of those investment decisions and devolution powers going to Scotland.
Mr Corbyn says he'll be campaigning in Scotland again soon. But as Labour supporters begin to gather in Brighton, he knows Scottish delegates will be watching him and the leadership contenders closely. David Porter reporting, Scotland.
Thousands of horse racing fans have been left disappointed after a prestigious three-day event in Ayr was abandoned because of a waterlogged course. It's emerged that the opening of a new five-mile stretch of dual carriageway on the A9 near Aviemore has been delayed because of problems with safety barriers. The Scottish Government's aiming to dual the whole route between Perth and Inverness by 2025, but critics are doubtful. Andrew Thompson reports.
Back in August, the Scottish Government said the first part of their A9 dualling project was just days away from completion. But now, 4 weeks later, problems with a small section of safety barriers have been blamed for causing a delay. However, some suspect other reasons are at play as well.
On Monday when I went down, it wasn't safety barriers that was the problem. It was landscaping and also the fact that there appeared to be a problem with the drains. My concern is this is probably the easiest section. If you look at it, it's following the existing road. It's fairly simple. It's flat. If they're having problems here, what problems are they going to have when they get to the Schlock summit?
The Scottish Government insists that the wider A9 dualling scheme is on target and has dismissed suggestions of other issues.
This particular case has been caused by a barrier which got past the designers, it got past the independent designers that then checked it, but then we finally found out there was a requirement to bring it up to a higher standard. So it's absolutely right that we make sure we have the highest possible safety standards on the A9, and just for a few more days, if we can get this right, then we'll have a 5-mile piece of road which will significantly reduce frustration.
This upgrade of the A9 is aimed at improving journey times and also making the road safer by making it easier for drivers to overtake slow-moving vehicles. However, in the short term at least, journeys are taking longer and drivers are facing hold-ups.
It was 40 miles an hour, but I mean, we were travelling about 15 miles an hour all the way up.
It is a bit frustrating with the traffic building up and that, but once it's finished, I think it'll be a good thing.
For me, personally, it's not an issue. It's rather do the job better and right the first time than spend more time getting a fix.
Andrew Thompson, reporting Scotland, Kincraig.
Tomorrow lunchtime, Rangers and Celtic meet for the first time this season. Before that, there's another big match in Glasgow near Ibrox. Different sport, though. Tonight, the Warriors play Irish team Munster in rugby's Pro 14 league. The world's best climbers are set to descend on Edinburgh this weekend as the capital hosts the Climbing World Cup and Paraclimbing Cup. And that is Reporting Scotland.